This is Whitley Strieber, and this is a Dreamland video presentation. You have reached the edge of the world. Today on Dreamland, we've got a guest who's been with us before, one of the real experts on UFOs and the history of the UFO cover-up. He's written a new book called UFOs and the Deep State, a history of the military and shadow government's war against the truth. I'm talking, of course, to Kevin Randle, Lieutenant Colonel USAR, a retired. Kevin Randle has written about this subject many, many times and is one of the world's great experts. And it's so important, I think, that we look at the history of this, while at the same time, the general public is being fed not exactly a lie, but a deception, I would say, that makes it look like it sort of all started in 2004. And the media is not going beyond before that. This is an old, old and very dark story that begins way before that. But Kevin, first, I want to welcome you back to Dreamland. And just to explain a little bit about Kevin, he was an Army Lieutenant Colonel. He served in Vietnam. He was a helicopter pilot, which meant that all those missions he flew, and there were over 1,000 of them, I believe, were flown mostly at under 1,500 feet, meaning that he was shot at by weapons that could easily penetrate a helicopter by people who knew how to use them a whole lot. He was also deployed in Iraq as an intelligence officer. He served on active duty with the Army and the Air Force. He's retired and has been for more than, after 22 years of service. He hosts a different perspective on the X-Zone Broadcast Network, and you can visit him at kevinrandle.blogspot.com, and there'll be links to all of that, of course, on the show description page. Kevin, it's a great honor and pleasure to welcome you back to Dreamland.
Well, I'll throw it right back at you. It's a great honor to be on Dreamland and talking to Whitley Strieber, one of my favorite horror writers.
Yeah, I have a number of hats. One of them is black. That's my horror writer hat. Yeah, before we started, Kevin was telling me about his reaction to the end of The Hunger, which you said creeped you out. And I said, well, it creeped me out too. That's the whole point. Actually, there's a strong possibility The Hunger is going to be remade into another movie by Warner Brothers. So,
well, I hope so, because the first movie was very disappointing.
I don't know what'll happen this time. All I know is that there's some interest in it.
I just couldn't wait to see the movie, and I was very disappointed when it came out because I didn't think it really captured the creepiness and the horror of the book.
Well, I have to say I had a slightly different reaction. First of all, I was absolutely nuts about Catherine Deneuve.
Well, yes, of course.
And I thought David Bowie did a great job, and so did Susan Sarandon. I thought the acting in the movie was fabulous.
I have no problems with the acting at all. No, I thought the acting was great. I agree with you.
And the scenes where David Bowie ages 30 years in a few days were really cool. Especially in those days, you know, there was no CGI or anything. It was all done with physical makeup and stuff. So it had its ups and downs, I guess, in terms of the script. But anyway, we're not here to talk about horror movies, although I love to do that, of course, and horror stories. I have no plans to go back into that field. It's been a long time since I wrote a horror story.
Well, let me turn tables on here just for a moment.
Sure.
I'm often accused, because I write science fiction, I've written a number of science fiction novels, and I'm always said, they always say to me as a disqualifier, well, you can't believe what he says because he writes science fiction. Do you run into that kind of an attitude? Well, we can't believe what you say because you write horror stories.
Oh, yes. Horror novelist Whitley Strieber now claims that he's part of a real horror story. You know, of course, they beat that to death. They absolutely beat it to death. And unfortunately, what happened, happened. And I think people have kind of accepted now, after my 30 years plus years of plugging away and never changing my story, or trying not to. I've been asked questions so many times in so many different ways. There are people who can go through all of my answers and look at tiny little differences here and there, and then claim, well, he's not telling the truth because he said here that they were wearing gray coveralls, and he said here that they were wearing brown coveralls 4 years later, you know. But
well, anybody who's done any kind of investigative work has spent years talking to witnesses about what they've seen, understand there's going to be subtle differences when you talk to them one day, when you talk to them another day, there's going to be those subtle differences. And it's not evidence of deceit, it's just evidence of the way human memory works.
That's exactly right. Human memory, especially traumatic memory, is very, very unstable. It's naturally unstable. The amazing thing about my memories of what happened to me in December of 85 is it has remained so stable over the years, and a lot of other memories too, but we're not here to talk about that today. We have got an extraordinary situation going on. The deep state appears to have at least sent up a conning tower in the form of suddenly these releases of UFO videos, and now the threat assessment, which apparently the classified part of it has a lot more detail in it than the 9 pages that were released to the public. But this all revolves around what the media has pretty much picked up on, essentially no history before 2004. I'm not saying the media is saying it's not there. It's just that they don't mention it because it's not being told to them, and they have essentially, the media has no history. They don't, they have today, yesterday, and maybe the day before, and that's it. The people in it, the editors and writers, except for places like maybe the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal or the Guardian, perhaps in England, they have no history. They have no idea of the past at all. So I might include the Washington Post in that group. But there is a huge past here. And I want to start by talking a little bit about the deep state. That term has been politicized to the point where it's almost useless. I understand the reason you used it in the title of your book, because it's a very intense catchphrase now. But it's not loopy conspiracy theories. It's not about that. There's something real here. And I want you to take us back to the 30s, to let's start with General Butler Stacy and what happened in the early 30s when the deep state was just beginning to form.
What we had was an election. Franklin Roosevelt was elected president, and there were a number of people who were unhappy with his policies, or his alleged policies, or his planned policies, what he wanted to do, what he wanted to accomplish. And what they thought they would do is they would pick this Marine general, the only man who would have won 3 medals of honor, had Marine officers been eligible to win the Medal of Honor. He actually won 2 of them. And I shouldn't say won, earned 2 of them. The first time Marine officers were not eligible to earn the Medal of Honor, he got some other kind of award. So he would have had 3. So a very respected man, very, very highly qualified, loved by literally all the veterans in the world at the time, I should say the American veterans at the time. And the plan was to bring him into the White House as sort of a chief of staff. And he would actually run the country, and Franklin Roosevelt would be more of a figurehead. And to his credit, General Butler decided not to participate in this. He didn't want to have a hand in it. He didn't think it was right. He went to the press with the story. There were congressional investigations, and it was concluded that he didn't have good evidence for what had happened. So it kind of got pushed aside. But when we look at the deep state, what we're talking about, if you look at the President Biden's administration today, who are in the top spots? Well, these were people who were in the top spots in the Obama administration and the Clinton administration and the Bush administration. It's the same people at the top of the government bureaucracies. They're not elected to those positions. They just retain them because of their connections. They've gone to the same schools. They know all the people at the top. They've worked in the government literally for decades. And so these are the people now controlling the deep state, and they can help make policy. They can kind of set policy. They can direct the president. You would think the president has the ultimate authority. And in researching the book, I came across the story that suggests the president doesn't have the ultimate authority. And what I mean by that is simply this. I was of the opinion, if I was president and I wanted to get information on UFOs, and I went to the director of Central Intelligence and I said, tell me what you can about UFOs. And if he said no, I would have said, you're fired, bring in your deputy. And I would go down the line until I got the information I wanted. But I learned that just doesn't work quite that way. When Jimmy Carter was elected president, as the president-elect, he went to the director of Central Intelligence, George H.W. Bush, and asked him about UFOs. And the director of Central Intelligence said, well, I would like to remain in this position after you're inaugurated. And Carter said, well, no, I have my own guy coming in for that. And Bush said, well, I'm not going to answer your questions. You don't have the need to know yet. You're not the president. And you would think, well, when he became president, he would be able to initiate the inquiries. But then they direct the things. And we see some of that going on today, as a matter of fact, where, well, we've got to pull the information away from all these different agencies. You'll have to give us some time to pull it all together. And somehow the ultimate secret just doesn't get revealed, isn't found. There are all these distractions and other things going on. So we get back into the 1930s and we can see that sort of thing going on. When General Smedley talked about the process, the plot to kind of replace the president make the president a figurehead and he would become the actual leader of the country. When the media investigated and the Congress investigated this, well, no, it wasn't quite that way. And we just really can't put our fingers on that. So that was the deep state protecting themselves from exposure. And we have that same thing going on today.
Now, at that time, there were congressional hearings, as you report, and General Smedley was discredited. But there was something very wrong with those hearings. Could you tell us a little bit about the whole issue of witnesses and the calling of witnesses in those hearings?
Well, we see the same thing today. We saw the same thing with the Warren Commission and the Kennedy assassination. They called the witnesses that would provide the information they wanted, and they ignored the witnesses that may say something untoward, something they don't want to hear. So yeah. They avoided specific witnesses, and that's the way it's always been. You've seen Congress calling actors and actresses to report on the states of affairs. What do these people have to know? Well, it's fun to talk to them, but they don't have an intimate knowledge. And you have show trials. You have committees that are designed to kind of obscure the facts. And the leaders of those committees know where they want to go. And so they are very carefully stage managed. And that's what we got here. We had a stage managed investigation that would tend to discredit the information provided by the general. But we can see from other sources that the information was all accurate. We have the ability of hindsight now to go back 90 years and look at this stuff and understand what was going on. And the people at the time didn't have the wherewithal to do that. We have tools today they didn't have, like the internet and all the various social media that can kind of point us in directions that the government doesn't want us to go. So things are kind of breaking apart there. The deep state is losing a little bit of control, and that's always what it's about, is control. The deep state wants to maintain control. That's what you have to remember. That's what they want.
I think they're very worried about that, and I think that they're trying to relieve some of the pressure that is going to build by releasing just a few crumbs of information about UAPs, as they are now called, and that term has a long history itself, unidentified flying object, and then APRO, I believe you report, changed that to, what was their
unidentified
term?
Unidentified aerial objects.
Yeah, UAO.
UAOs.
And now it's UAP, unidentified aerial phenomena, which distances it even more from the possibility of there being a physical component.
And that was the whole point of it. That was one of the arguments against unidentified flying objects. Well, if it's flying, then you're implying something about its controllability. And if it's an object, well, you're implying something about its physical existence. And APRO was a little bit concerned with the idea of the intelligence control. So I think it was Carl Lorenzen came up with the UAO, which removed that one element from it, but it still remained object. And now we're removing that from it as well. Well, a UAP can be anything, but a UFO can be anything as well. I think it's just a matter of semantics and the way of kind of diverting public attention.
Okay, we're going to start now talking about the cover-up, and then later we're going to be talking about people like General Arthur Exon, who Kevin interviewed and was introduced to. I believe you were introduced to Art by Stanton Friedman. Is that correct?
No, absolutely not. Stanton had nothing to do with it.
Well, how did it happen? Just, I'm very curious.
I was talking to J. Bond Johnson, who was a photographer, reporter for the Fort Worth Star-Telegram back in 1947. And he mentioned something about Arthur Exon to me, having some knowledge about it. And so I'm not sure whether I found the address or Don Schmidt found the address, but we learned where it was. I got the phone number of Arthur Exon, and I called him up to talk to him. I didn't want to lead him anywhere. So I said, well, I'm interested in the operations of flight operations at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base. And Arthur Exon had been the base commander.
Right.
I have to understand the base commander isn't necessarily the number one guy on the base. It's more like a mayor. And in fact, in the Army, they now call that function the mayor cell, because they're responsible for the physical facilities on the base and making sure that the plumbing works and getting people to clean up stuff and all of that sort of thing. Kind of the mayor, the city manager of the base. And there were people above him, but I was talking to him about his experiences at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base as the base commander, which I then was able to subtly direct into the Roswell case and learn a little bit about that. But the initial conversation began talking about what was going on at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base. And he told me this wonderful story about how he would get a call from Washington, D.C., and they would tell him to get an aircraft ready, and people would be coming in, and that aircraft would go out to investigate a UFO sighting. Not part of the Blue Book, but somebody else doing it.
And we've got to take a break right now, and we're going to get deeper into that as we go along, because as my listeners know, Arthur Exon was a family friend, and my uncle Mickey was very close to him, and they worked together on the Roswell materials at Wright Field when they first came in 1947. But that's a story that's been told on this show. The other story, and it's an incredible story, is the story that Kevin Randle will be telling about his interviews with and relationship with Arthur Exon. So we'll get to that in a little while. Free Dreamlanders, right now, just take this break. But don't go and have coffee. Go and do what we ask you to do on the commercials instead.
Support unknowncountry.com and its great mission to make contact happen. Use our vast archive of interviews, meditations, commentaries, news, and Whitley Strieber audiobooks to expand your mind and your understanding of Close Encounter. Meet others who have similar interests on our active free message board or in our subscriber comments and Wednesday night chats. There is no other site like Unknown Country in or out of this world. Go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today.
How curious are you? How much do you really want to know about the world you live in? There are, for example, very real conspiracies. We're talking about one of them today. And this is a place where if it's real, we're going to talk about it, but not if it's not real. So there's no confusion here. If we're talking conspiracy on Dreamland and on unknowncountry.com, it's because we can prove it, just like we can prove that the Roswell incident has been covered up. We can prove these things. We can prove that the abduction phenomena is in some way very real. We can prove that there are unusual materials in this world because some of them are right here in my possession. So, this is an unusual place. It's a unique place. And above all, it is a great place to explore. Exploring the unknowncountry.com archive is a really extraordinary experience. It's a place where you can regain what we are losing, which is a lost sense of wonder and a willingness and to explore the unknown. We live in a terribly difficult world right now. This place is an oasis of wonder. Join unknowncountry.com today. There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is, if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is, can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved? Can we take it? A new world. It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is. And it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook, and Kindle. We're talking to Kevin Randle. His new book, UFOs and the Deep State, a history of the military and shadow government's war against the truth. His website is kevinrandle.blogspot.com, and you can enjoy his podcast, A Different Perspective, on the X Zone Broadcast Network. Kevin, I want to go back to the beginning of the cover-up now, and we will return to Arthur Exon and some of the other principal figures in this and later. And in my life, Art is a principal figure, although I'm not sure how there's a difference between what he said to you and what he probably said to me and said to my family. So, okay. Now, let's go back to 1947. Now, by this time, there is a deep state, and it's pretty big because we've had World War II. We have now got not a centrally yet organized intelligence structure, but a lot of different nodes in the intelligence field, all of which are people who are appointed. And we have the War Office is going to just about to become the Defense Department, and the War Department is going to become the Defense Department, and it's going to this infrastructure that Dwight Eisenhower will later warn against is just forming. Now, something happens in July of 1947, and what, take it from there.
Well, let me back you up just a smidgen. Something happened in June of 1947, which was Kenneth Arnold seeing these objects in fast flight over Mount Rainier, Washington. And that kind of launched the flying saucer craze in the United States. There had been a similar craze in Sweden in 1946 in Scandinavia with the ghost rockets and, of course, the Foo Fighters of World War II. These were all investigated by elements of American intelligence. The Foo Fighters, they never resolved simply because the war ended. It was no longer a priority. The ghost rockets were getting a lot of attention in Scandinavia and Northern Europe in 1946, but the news media was suppressed, told not to report this stuff anymore, and it kind of went away. Then we have Kenneth Arnold in June of 1947, the United States, talking about these objects he'd seen, and the term flying saucer was coined at that point. Then just about 2 weeks later, something falls in Roswell, New Mexico. Everybody agrees something fell. The question is, what did they find? We have Jesse Marcel, who was the Air Intelligence Officer of the 509th Bomb Group, going out there saying he recovered parts of a flying saucer. We have Sheridan Cabot, who was Counterintelligence Officer at Roswell in 1947, accompanying Marcel out there and say, well, no, it's just parts of a balloon. What happens is the material has gone, part of the material has gone, sent to Fort Worth. It's identified by General Ramey as a balloon. The news media lose interest because who cares? It's a balloon. Marcel says, but the stuff that General Ramey showed in his office was not what we found in New Mexico. The cover-up begins at that point. What's interesting is after the Arnold sighting, you have the newspapers covering the reports of flying saucers endlessly, speculation all over the place. What are they? Are they? They were talking interplanetary as opposed to interstellar at the time. Are they Soviet? Are they alien creatures from another world? Are they mirages? Are they delusions? What's going on? Is it some form of hysteria? July 8th, it's announced that the Roswell Army Airfield has captured a flying saucer in the region. The newspapers go nuts. What do you got? 3 hours later, General Ramey says, well, here it is. It's a weather balloon. And that ends it. Reporters can't find Marcel because he's at Fort Worth, not in Roswell. The sheriff in Roswell, George Wilcox.
Yeah, Wilcox.
When he's interviewed, he says, I can't talk about it. I'm working with the boys out at the base. They can't find the rancher because he's being held at the base. And even if he wasn't, he'd have been up near Corona and they wouldn't have been able to find him anyway. All the primary people are gone and you have the general officer saying it's nothing but a weather balloon. So the story just kind of dies at that point. But what's interesting, the Roswell story dies at the point, but the next day, the very next day, July 9th, there's stories, I think it's an Associated Press story that says, that went out to newspapers all over the country, that the Army and Navy moved today to suppress stories of flying saucers whizzing through the atmosphere. And the question is why? Up until July 8th, they didn't care what the press was reporting. Suddenly, something falls in Roswell, it's recovered, and now suddenly, the military is trying to suppress the stories. And the number of articles and information about UFOs, flying saucers, decreases immensely at that point. They think they've got the whole thing hidden. Ed Ruppelt, who was the chief of Project Blue Book in the early 1950s, said that in the summer of 1947, July of 1947, the Pentagon was in a panic over these things. They didn't know what it was. They're concerned about it. Suddenly they've got one falling in Roswell, New Mexico. So now they know that it's nothing the Soviets have or any of our competitors in the world have. They realize what it is, and they're wondering if there's not an invasion fleet standing off around the moon or something in Independence Day to invade Earth. But as time progresses and the invasion doesn't come, and the reports of flying saucers fall off because people don't know where to report them, the news media is not covering, they think everything is okay. But the military does something called an estimate of the situation. And General Shulgin, George Shulgin, was an intelligence officer, and they'd gathered 16, what they thought, very credible reports. And this was what we call the mini estimate of the situation. And he sent it on to the Air Materiel Command, where that kind of research was done, the intelligence function was operating, to analyze these 16 reports. And it resulted in a letter by General Nathan Twining, who said the phenomenon is something real and not illusionary or fictitious. So he's telling General Shulgin, in a sense, what was just said to the Congress, something's going on. We need to investigate. And he sets up a program to investigate it. It became Project Sign, the first of the Air Force projects. But the point here is, without answering the questions, Twining set up a program to investigate it. And that kind of got everybody calmed down. We're going to investigate this. In 1949, Project Sign was ended. They said, well, we've investigated. There's nothing to it. Here's our report. We're done. All they did was change the name to Project Grudge. They kept on marching. Did the same thing in, I think, 1951. Grudge came out with a final report, said there's nothing to it. We're done. They changed the name to Project Blue Book, kept on going. In January of 1953, the Robertson panel was formed. This was a bunch of scientists, about five scientists, to review the Project Blue Book information. It was sponsored by the CIA. And what they did was said, there's nothing to it. It's hallucinations, it's fictitious, it's myth-making. What we need to do is debunk the entire phenomenon. And we do this by manipulating the press, getting Disney to make some movies about how we have these mysterious UFO sightings and we were able to solve them. Suggest to teachers not to allow students to do reports on flying saucers. They were forcing the media and the educational system and the general public, the civilians, if you will, to follow their lead on what to do about it, thinking this is going to end the whole thing. Now we move to 2004 or 2017, and we have the UAPs running around, the Navy saying, well, the videos are real, meaning they were taken by Navy personnel, not necessarily the object in the video is an alien spacecraft, but the videos are real. I think we're moving to Twining 2.0, which is simply, they're going to say, well, you know, we looked at this stuff, we were confused for a while, here are the answers, we can go about our business without worrying about alien visitation.
I agree with you there. I know some of the people, of course, who are involved in this, and they're, one of them said to me that we hope that the whole abduction phenomenon just goes away, that it's never brought up by the media. Unfortunately, that's not going to happen, I'm sure. I'm certainly not going to go running around looking for sending out press releases or anything, because that's not my job. My job is to respond to social need, not to generate stuff like that. So, however, let's keep going. And there's a huge question here.
May I interrupt for just a moment here? Because you mentioned,
right ahead, please.
You mentioned abductions, and they're not going to go away. Philip Mantle from Flying Disc Press in the United Kingdom has published a couple of books about the Hicks and Parker abduction from 1973, Pascagoula.
Yes.
And the problem with that abduction had always been, well, we don't have any additional witnesses. And what they've been able to find are additional witnesses, people who observed either the light or the object or something relating to that abduction. And he's worked with Calvin Parker. I think Charles Hickson has passed away.
Yes.
He's worked with Calvin Parker on producing this book. So we get Calvin Parker's abduction scenario back into the public arena. And I think there's a documentary coming out about it and a couple of follow-on books. So that hope that the abduction phenomenon is going to go away in that sense is not going to happen, because we have this ongoing investigation into the Hicks and Parker abduction. And I think it's making some interesting progress.
Yeah, Phil is a terrific guy. He's done a wonderful job on this. And we have interviewed Calvin Parker and him a number of couple of times on Dreamland, most recently in 2018, when they came forward with this new witnesses book. And so, you know, it's an important story, because what has happened there is that over time, what was generally dismissed as absolute nonsense has turned out to have some real substance. And that's going to be true, I think, of many, many of the close encounter stories. But what I want to do now is I want to get into the reasons for the cover-up and what it is about a bureaucracy that causes it to cling to secrets like they do. They all do it. I mean, the Department of Commerce has its own secrecy. The NASA, which has in its charter that it's not supposed to keep secrets, keeps secret after secret after secret. Bureaucracies hide things. When we get back, we're going to talk to Kevin about the history of secrecy and why this particular subject is so very secret. We'll be right back. There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is, if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is, can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved? Can we take it? A new world. It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is, and it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook, and Kindle. We're talking to Kevin Randle. His new book, UFOs and the Deep State, A History of the Military and Shadow Government's War Against the Truth. Now, if you really want to understand, you've got to know the past. The media is, for some reason, known only to them, in the process of deciding that it has no past. For the media, as we've said before, it starts now in 2004. It didn't start then. This has all happened before. There've been congressional hearings. There've been all kinds of things, disclosures, et cetera, and so forth before. And yet we still are kind of on this treadmill, running and running and running. And it feels like we're going somewhere, but we're really not. Now, also Kevin, let me go back to his podcast. You can find it on the X-Zone Broadcast Network. It's A Different Perspective. His website is kevinrandle.blogspot.com. Now let's go back to the point where they now know that this is something very strange. General Exon told me, and I think this was sort of a soundbite he had created. I think he may have told you these same words, and perhaps also Stanton Friedman. Everyone from Truman on down knew that this was not of this world within 24 hours of our finding it. There were debris, there were bodies taken from Roswell to Fort Worth and then to Wright. Why was it so secret?
Because they didn't know what they had exactly. We've just come out of a horrendous war, and suddenly this craft from another world crashes. They don't know whether there's an invasion coming. They don't know anything about it. They need time to do their research and their investigation to learn exactly what's going on. So classifying it and diverting the press and the attention in July of 1947 makes perfect sense. You've got to be able to answer questions. I mean, we can see just our recent past with the pandemic, how the information just morphed from one thing to another, to another, to another, with people not knowing exactly what's going on, or people knowing what's going on and trying to hide that information to make it not as bad as it seemed, or to make it worse than it seems, for monetary reasons or personal reasons or reasons of power. So in 1947, we're dealing with the same sort of thing. They don't know what they're dealing with. They know that they've got something very unusual. If we can decode it, if we can figure out how it works, we take a huge step over our competitors in the world by exploiting this spy. They need to keep it secret. So it makes perfect sense in 1947. I have no problems with that. The question becomes, and why does that persist today? And it's all about power. We know from our history that anytime a technologically superior civilization comes into contact with a technologically inferior civilization, that technologically inferior civilization ceases to exist. Doesn't mean necessarily through conquest or warfare. The mere introduction of the technology is sometimes sufficient to destroy a society. And we've seen examples of that. One of the best ones is from our anthropological history, where an anthropologist went to study a primitive society, and they had a social network set up. If you needed to borrow a stone axe, you had to go through a series of things to get to the leaders of that society to ask permission to use a stone axe. Well, the anthropologist showed up with a whole bunch of steel axes. And to induce the people to talk to him, he said, well, we'll give you this steel axe. Well, a steel axe is much better than a stone axe. So now he's undercut the part of the civilization, part of the things that keeps the civilization together, because they no longer need the stone axe. They have a much superior axe. But the other problem is they can't make them. They have to depend on the outside civilization to supply the steel axes. They can't make steel axes because they don't know how to make steel. They don't have metallurgy. They don't know any of that stuff. So now we have a technology that has supplanted the societal underpinnings of this one group. And we can see that throughout the world. And that's part of the problem we run in here. If they admit there's this technologically superior civilization and they have artifacts from it, then the question becomes is where are those artifacts and what can they tell us? What can they help us develop that would improve human existence? And I think they're worried about retaining their power. And one of the ways they retain their power is by keeping this secret. They have to retain their power. That's why the secrecy persists today. It began in 1947, and I think for very good reasons, but it has morphed into this idea of we have to keep this secret because we must retain our positions of power.
One of the things that doesn't happen is that the visitors, if whatever they are, don't seem to land. In other words, they have extensive interactions with people and have had with thousands of people. I'm quite sure. I feel strongly about that. They fly around in the sky. My wife Anne used to say, they want us to see them. It's a theater in the sky. But they don't actually finalize it. In other words, they don't become a concrete presence like they would if they landed in a park or and walked around. We have just a few fuzzy possible pictures of apparent aliens in this world. They've been extremely careful, in other words, to control their own exposure to us. And mirroring that is the cover-up. Is there a connection between the two, Kevin, do you think? In other words, is the cover-up somehow reflecting the will of whatever is out there?
I don't think there's really any connection. I think the visitation that we talk about, we do have some very good cases of interaction with the environment, the electromagnetic effects where they stole car engines. We had a wonderful example in Levelland, Texas in 1957, where people at 13 or 14 separate locations reported a close approach of a UFO that stalled the car engine and dimmed their lights. And yes. When the UFO went away, the cars began to operate properly again.
Oddly enough, the father of one of my closest friends in those days was one of those people in Levelland. He was in the Levelland experience. So we boys, when after that happened and he came home and told the story, we were just alive with fascination about flying saucers, as you may imagine. But go ahead.
Well, it wasn't just Levelland. You look at 1957, especially around the 2nd, 3rd, 4th, and 5th of November of 1957, we've got an awful lot of reports from around the country of this sort of thing going on. And you can see there was a similar event in 1954 in France, Europe, France mainly, South America, same sort of thing. But oftentimes they were seen with alien beings outside the craft as the car engine stalled. And the people who were the witnesses were sometimes paralyzed, couldn't move until the object left. So we see an evolution of the way that things operated. But we get into the 1990s, we don't see those many more. That's suggestive of either a change in their technology or a different group operating. But we do have some interesting cases of the objects interacting with the environment that way. We have landing trace cases. I think Ted Phillips logged some 4,600 cases of UFOs landing and leaving burn spots and impressions in the ground. Socorro, New Mexico, 1964. The police officer, Lonnie Zamora, saw the landed craft. The alien being saw it take off. And within minutes, they found the impressions in the ground from where the thing had sat. And so we have those sorts of things going on. So we have some interactions with the environment, but it's also, as you say, kind of their guarding their own secrecy. They're trying to maybe introduce themselves cautiously to our civilization so they don't frighten us with their sudden presence. But that's speculation on my part. But we do see evidence of them flying around at night with the lights on. Philip Glass, the great debunker, always had a great line that kind of cracked me up. He says, well, if they don't want us to know where they're here, why don't they turn off the lights? And you have to say, well, that's a very good question. Why don't they turn off the lights? But it seems to suggest that they're not overly sensitive to our perceiving them. So we have to look at all of that. The one thing we do not have in the public arena that you and I don't have is a piece of debris or something that proves an alien visitation that you could take into the laboratory and examine carefully and say, this was not from this planet. It came from somewhere else. The one thing that's always scared me is we find a piece of alien debris. We have a real piece of a flying saucer. It's legitimate flying saucer. It's taken to the lab and they analyze it. And they said, yeah, it's aluminum. There's nothing to distinguish aluminum made on another world than aluminum is made on our planet. It doesn't prove it. You need something a little bit more. I think everybody has to set their own threshold of evidence, where they want to step over that threshold. Is it just the number of sightings? Is it landing traces? Is it the electromagnetic effects? Is it the abduction phenomenon? What is your level to move to the extraterrestrial? Some people want solid physical evidence or the interaction with the environment. Some people say, well, I'm not going to be happy until I see the bodies and the craft. That's the only thing that's going to prove it to me. And I think that's kind of an absurd level to reach, because we can reach the level of, yeah, they're here, it's extraterrestrial, without having the actual physical bodies of the actual craft.
Well, I think also it's fairly clear that they haven't given us much. In other words, the ace in the hole is how that propulsion system works. Just recently, we've had Jeff Bezos go up in a rocket, and the other various other private industry is moving into space in a big way, commercializing space. But with rockets, and you, when I saw Jeff Bezos go up in his rocket, I thought to myself, that's basically not what we need. Because that space tourism, sure, flying around the planet for 10 minutes or whatever and coming back again would be fun. I'd love to do it, but I happen to be short about $28 million, so I can't. But the thing is, we need to expand off of this planet in the worst way. As you see these terrible fires in Oregon, in Siberia, the unbelievable heat waves in the Arctic, hundreds of people and homes being ravaged in Germany by bizarre floods, all kinds of stuff like that. The planet is not holding together. The environment is collapsing, and we need more space. We need, and we're not going to get it with rockets. We're going to get it with what they have.
We can get to the other planets in the solar system in rockets, chemical
rockets.
Yeah,
but I mean, who wants to
get us out of the solar system? And that's what we need to do. We need to get out of the solar system.
We need to be able to get out of the solar system. And they didn't come from this solar system, it doesn't look like.
No.
If they did, they're very well hidden.
There's no place for them to have to be other than maybe maintaining bases somewhere. And again, that's speculation. Right. But they have to come from outside the solar system, which means interstellar flight is possible. And yet we're still fooling around with chemical rockets. We have talked about ways of traveling between the stars with great solar sails or using the hydrogen that is, I guess, throughout space and using it as a fuel and picking up as you go along. But we need to do something more than a chemical rocket where we put the fuel in the rocket and then we go off. We've got to be able to find a way to refuel as we travel. And the distances are just so fantastic. If the speed of light is a limiting factor, then we have a real problem. If there was a way to defeat the speed of light, which clearly there is, if they're visiting us from other planets,
yes,
then we've got to figure that out as well so that we can make those sorts of moves.
Right. Since they are here, there has to be a way of projecting yourself, and I don't say moving because that's probably not an appropriate word here, of projecting yourself from place to place in this universe that does not involve travel at the speed of light. Because folks, the speed of light is mighty, mighty fast. But when you're talking about going between stars, it's mighty, mighty slow. You're not going to get anywhere fast with that.
If you could go from zero to the speed of light instantly, it would take us 4 years to get to the nearest star system. But
right.
The problem is you can't do that. You have to accelerate to the speed of light. And when you get to the other end, you have to slow down. And that creates additional problems or additional time frames. Yeah, there's got to be a better way of doing it. And if they're getting here from there, then they figured out how to do it. And we just haven't yet.
You know, there's a very interesting thing going on in physics, because without talking about this, a lot of physicists, I think, are looking at what they're seeing and what the government is finally admitting is real and thinking to themselves, well, wait a minute, somebody can do the impossible, therefore it isn't impossible.
Once you've told somebody that something is possible, they're going to figure out a way to do it. They might figure out a better way of doing it. And that's maybe one of the big secrets, that if they can do it, then we should be able to do it. We're not looking in the right place.
Well, there are two basic models. There are more than two, but two very interesting. One is the standard model of basically the way the universe works. There's another one called the Randle-Sundrum model. And this model postulates many dimensions. And it is possible, I think, that that's the correct model. Because if you assume that this model is correct, then their papers have been written showing how human traversable wormholes under this model of the universe could exist. Under the standard model, they can't exist. They can't exist for the simple reason that it requires two points on the universe to be joined. And the only way to do that under the standard model is to bend the universe so that they touch each other, however briefly. But you're not going to bend it without having more energy than it contains. So therefore, it's impossible. This other model postulates that there are dimensions that have a different relationship to distance. And if that's the case, it might be that they aren't flying across the vastness of space at all, but they're stepping from their living rooms into our living rooms in a single step. And that these devices that we see aren't even man, that they're just robotic devices doing whatever they do. And it's an amazing possibility anyway.
Well, I think that, you know, we open up so many avenues of research and avenues of expansion if we can figure out how to do it.
And yeah, absolutely.
That's kind of the Fermi paradox is, well, if there's life on other planets in the galaxy, how come they haven't gotten here yet?
And, well, of course, the problem with that is apparently they have. Well, it's not the Randle syndrome model, folks. It's the Randle, R-A-N-D-A-L-L, syndrome, S-U-N-D-R-U-M model. I know some of you are going to want to look that up. And I will make sure there's a link in the show as well, because my listeners are, a lot of them are very sophisticated in terms of their understanding of things like physics, and they're going to want to think about this. So
that was always the great thing about science fiction. When the first atomic bombs were exploded, and they said, well, there's maybe 2,000 scientists that understand the concept and 500,000 science fiction fans that understood it. And so science fiction fans understood some of these concepts. And that's the other interesting thing at science fiction conventions. There's always an interest in UFOs. You know, science fiction writers, for the most part, are kind of reluctant to talk about flying saucers and that sort of thing. But whenever Don or I were at a convention, science fiction convention, to talk about UFOs, we always ended up with the largest venue, because we would have the room crowded with people interested in what we had to say. Because, of course, alien space flight and space travel is a science fiction type topic.
Right. And the interesting thing is that it is very often true that ideas that turn out to be useful in the practical world start in the imagination. And I have a feeling that it's going to turn out that our ability to travel between the stars is going to start with science fiction. It's going to turn out that some of those stories weren't too far off the mark.
Well, the interesting thing is, if you remember the movie Apollo 13,
yes,
Robin Howard did, there's a scene in there where they kind of show the rocket heading off toward the moon. And I looked at that scene and I said, I don't know how many times I saw a similar scene in the science fiction movies of the 1950s. And here we are 15 years later from the time of the science fiction movies, where that's science fact. And now we're looking on it as history.
Right. Well, you know, I think Arthur C. Clarke's Childhood's End might explain one of the reasons that what we were talking about a little earlier, that the visitors don't come forth. One of the reasons could be that we literally can't handle them, because goodness, being an abductee, been face to face with them myself, it's not easy at all.
But in Arthur C. Clarke's Childhood's End, the alien creatures looked an awful lot like the representations of Satan or the devil.
Well, exactly. That's my point. And people have these ideas of the reptilians and so forth. And I could easily have decided I was in the clutches of demons that night in 1985, for sure. But it didn't occur to me, because I'm a pretty secular person. And, you know, I didn't have demons in my mind. What I did have were bugs, being from Texas, where there are a lot of big bugs. And all of a sudden, I had either shrunk or the bugs had gotten really big. That was sort of what was in my mind that night. But we're going to, in the third half hour, which we're coming to fairly soon, a couple of minutes, we're going to be talking more about the principles in this and the people, because both Kevin and I knew Arthur Exon, and Kevin has written a previous book that we discussed some years ago on the show, I believe in 2015, called Encounter in the Desert. And we're going to talk about that too, because it's, I've got the wrong book. It's The Truth About the UFO Crash at Roswell, where you have the interview with Exon. Is that correct?
I think we talk about him in both the UFO Crash at Roswell, The Truth About the UFO Crash at Roswell. We kind of expanded. We had opportunities to meet with him subsequent times after the first book.
Okay, so that's why I'm a little confused, because it must be in a number of different of your different books. Anyway, we're going to get deeply into this because it's a very important part of the story. And I think that before we go, that it seems clear to me that whatever's out there has probably intentionally not clued us in. And they're doing that, I would think, for ethical reasons. And this is just my opinion, that there's something called cultural colonization. And when you're talking about the advanced cultures showing up and destroying the earlier culture, the more primitive culture, I think that what's going on here, a big part of it is they don't want that to happen. They want our culture to remain intact. And they're kind of in a race against time, though, aren't they? Because our planet's falling apart at the same time that we're getting used to them. And are we going to get used to them in time to enable them to help us or not? I don't know. But what I think is probably going to happen, and this is just a guess, we are going to figure out how they move around. And like it or not, all of a sudden, we're not going to be going up in a rocket for an 11-minute journey into outer space for $20 million. We're going to be able to jump across the universe just like they do. And folks, because they better watch out. The universe better watch out, because here we come, if that happens. Kevin Randle, what a great book it is. And folks, it's so important to get the perspective, to learn about the past. Don't let yourself drop into the deep state's little rabbit hole and along with the general media and assume that this is all sort of recent. It's not recent. It's integral to our world and the way we live. 50 years of disinformation, saboteurs, intimidation, and cover-ups. Let's put an end to it. We don't do that by simply listening to the latest story or the latest little bit of information dripped out. UFOs in the deep state, look at the past, understand history in order to understand the present. And the other same thing is, the book's a hell of a lot of fun to read. It's a really fascinating, I could not put it down. Kevin Randle's website is kevinrandle.blogspot.com. His podcast is A Different Perspective on the X-Zone Broadcast Network. And Free Dreamlanders, goodbye. It's been lovely having you. I wish you were subscribers. And you don't know it, maybe, but so do you. Because right now, we're going to go into an intimate conversation about a man we both knew who was deeply involved in this whole business right at the beginning, General Arthur Exon. Subscribers, will keep right on keeping on.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.